I had an automobile. I didn't have any money to get it fixed, and I didn't have any man in the house that could fix it. So I had to have the car in order to work, and somebody had to fix it, and my boy was taking automobile mechanics, just starting, and I figured if a 15-year-old kid could learn to fix a car, so could I. I found, talking to employers, that we still have a lot of dyed-in-the-wool employers that figure a woman belongs home barefooted and pregnant. Well, I'd probably ask him how many women he'd had in his employment, and if he tells me none, I'd probably use the old expression that you don't knock it if you haven't tried it, and that he might be missing a very good opportunity to have a good, productive employee in his firm.
Well, the main reason I wanted this job is because before I held secretarial jobs, which were not, of course, good-paying jobs. Now I'm making good money, I'm learning a trade, and I'm supporting an 11-year-old daughter.
I have bills and a son to support, and I know that most of the jobs that qualified as men's jobs pay more money.
It doesn't really bother me to wear this hard hat and the gear that goes with it. I mean, I know I have to support my children, and if I'm going to be gone 8 to 9 hours a day away from home, I'm going to be making money.
To me, welding is not hard, and I really love to weld. It's dirty, as you can see. But other than that, I really love to weld.
I'm a member of Teamsters, Local 538. I couldn't see wasting my time as a secretary, to be truthful, because the money just wasn't there, and at the time I had 2 kids to support. And it just seemed like this was a lot better suited for me.
I like to get up in the morning and be really feeling good about going to work instead of hating it and hating my job. And this type of job I really love. I really get excited about. So I don't think there'd be any problem about getting up in the morning and heading out the door.
I do like the challenge, and I also feel that craftsmen have built this country, and I want to be a craftsman.
Now back during World War II, it wasn't unusual to have between 500 and 700 females working in such jobs as welding and shift fitting. And that was because we had a shortage of manpower then, and we needed all the women that we could get. But since that time, we haven't had a need to hire females until such time as 1972. Since that period of time, we have hired slightly over 300 females. And at this point, we're still running close to 200 working in such areas as transportation, the incentive department, welding, burning, ship fitting. We have had a couple in shipping. Our previous experience has been, from the standpoint of retention, that we haven't found any marked difference between that of basically male or female. My personal say would be that it takes a certain character, more or less, to adopt to the shipyard type of work, as opposed to the fact that somebody's either a male or a female.
And right now we have about 65, 70 bus operators, female bus operators around the system. At first we had some problems, but as the population of the women became larger, we found that there was no significant difference between the women and the men that we employ in that capacity. It's been a very successful program as far as we're concerned. We've found, in fact, that the turnover rate among women is lower than it is among men. The other thing that really surprised us, I think most of the male supervisors said, well, you know, we're going to have the problem with absenteeism. The women are going to be absent more than the men. That's not been the case. We've found that women are at least as good as the men in almost all categories, accidents, absenteeism. That's not to say we don't have some bad ones, but then we have some bad men too. But there is no significant statistical difference. They perform just as well, and we're just as pleased with their operation of the vehicles as we are with the men.
We have 2 women in our motor inspector apprenticeship training program at the present time, and 1 in our machinist apprenticeship training program. I would say that they're doing, in some cases, better than average, but in no case worse than average. Their absenteeism and general demeanor has been the same as the other apprentices.
See, our contract is made for the individual, and it doesn't consider whether they're black or female or Italians or anything, or Presbyterians or whatever it may be. When they come in and start working all over, they accept them. They were good workers. They made the men work. They worked too damn hard.
We've had complaints as far as her receiving better work, and the shop stewards have gotten into it. It's a simple fact that she produces better than some, so naturally we're going to steer her into that work. We want to get the most productivity. I think one of the reasons she is here and she produces the way she does is because of the family that she's got to support. Her husband left her several years ago, and she's got to earn her living and everything to support her family.
We've found to have our most success in hiring a person who really needs a job or who really wants the job.
Around this area here, we have a lot of depression and pocket depressions, if you want to call them, where the husband doesn't bring enough money home. Right now, kid going to college or for some family reason, or the high mortgage payments you have today, two of them must work. So I see that's good. That means that they're working because of a need. And this is what I like to see.
Gail is kind of it's a little bit different in that Gail was actually interviewed for a secretarial position in my office. She was very qualified. She had an associate degree in secretarial sciences. And after talking with Gail, we found out that really what Gail was interested in was in actually working with her hands and being a technician. And after some investigation and some arrangements, she was put into this kind of work. I think it's tremendous because I think Gail is going to be a tremendous asset to our department.
Our purchasing department went out looking to find personnel for the shop, and we went down to the Calvert Educational Center where Mary was, and we saw her, where she worked, and the things that she was doing down there, and we decided to hire her. Now she's been with us 9 months, and I'd say she's just about at the point now where she can take any job that we have for her on a lathe and complete it without any problem whatsoever. When we did hire her, I had a little reservation because I've never had any females in the machine shop before. But it's worked out very well. The people in the shop have accepted her very well. And now it's the type of thing to where we regard her as just one of the fellas, you might say, and we don't recognize her as being a female or a different individual from everybody else, you know. She's here to do a job and does it well, and we don't look at her as any different than anybody else in the shop.
People you work for go ahead and work for you, no problem. But it's only somebody who's never had a female supervisor. They look at you as if to see if you're for real. But once they find out that you mean business, it's no problem at all. Some of them welcome female supervisors.
Well, when I first came in the shop, which was 25 months ago, it was a new experience for me to be working with all men. There were two of us who came into the shop, and they at first didn't know how to react to us or us to them, except that we were a novelty, let's say, you know. And like, they may say something out of line or use a swear word, and right away they were apologizing. Now, more or less, we're treated as one of the guys.
You know, the women are playing ping pong and carrying on conversations with the men. It's a normal social atmosphere. We do not find that there's any differentiation made because of a person's sex.
The men are, you know, really, they're helpful. You know, if they see you doing something, you know, it seems to them too hard. They say, hey, you know, don't do that, you know, you're a woman. And I say, well, I'm trying, you know, let me try.
When I first had to pick up a floor joist, I couldn't do it. I couldn't lift one end of it. And by the time I left the job, I was carrying them, you know, all by myself.
They can physically handle the job is quite all right with me. I certainly don't object to it. And by the same token, I certainly object to people of the male sex who can't perform heavy work. I don't like them doing heavy work.
We thought we might have to alter some phases of the job, but it hasn't proven to be a fact. Some of the windows that we handle on our trucks are pretty heavy. They weigh up to 100 pounds, and they have to be moved 40 feet from the back of the trailer to the front. And we thought this might be a problem, but it hasn't proven to be any problem to us so far.
A man is well coordinated because of sports. For that reason, he's geared toward in that direction to be able to use his body to be a more effective worker, where the female is not. Now, I see in the next generation, they're going to be the same as the men. Not as strong, but maybe stronger, I don't know. We got some strong women in that plant. I'd hate to tangle with one of them I can think of real quick.
The women will work in this organization, they'll fit into this organization very well. as long as they're prepared to come in and not expect us to treat them as a woman, but to treat them as an employee.
But once they get into the mill, then we have a responsibility and an obligation to make sure that they receive their rights within the plant.
The question came up as to whether or not she could eventually do that work, and there was some consideration to the fact that she might not be able to do it, and therefore we ought to question whether we should maintain her beyond a probationary period. I went down and investigated the job, and we discovered that the majority of the males that had come through prior to her had never gotten into that area of work as soon as she was required to do it.
Some members of the public don't take too well to women operators. You know, the myth about women drivers is still there, and they get on the bus and there's a woman driver there. They're not actually going to take out their hostilities. But the women work out well. We don't have a problem with that. They seem to fit into the scheduling pretty well. We don't have the problems we anticipated with the women. We have the number of attacks, but it's no greater than it is with the men. A woman has to be prepared for that. It's a tough job. It's tough physically. It's tough mentally. You're dealing with the public, and you're dealing sometimes with a pretty violent public. But if they're prepared to accept that, then they're going to fit into the job pretty well.
We're very happy with the women that we have, and I would like to have more women apply for the apprenticeship training programs.
You know, we grew up with my father being a carpenter. And my sister and I would always stand around being his helper, handing him tools, and we'd hold a board. And I remember the one thing was, one of my biggest fears was with his level. Don't bump the level, you know. So I handle that with care even now. He did most of the complicated work, but, you know, I nailed up some drywall and a few things, and I really enjoyed it, you know, really enjoyed the work, asked him a lot of questions, and that's really where my interest came in. Well, my father and I were building this kitchen together. And I don't know how much longer it would have taken us to complete it, but my father was killed in a construction accident, and the kitchen wasn't finished, but I had a lot of contact with people from the union at that time, and met a lot of carpenters and a few business agents. One of the business agents told me if we needed help finishing the kitchen to call him, and he'd send some men out. So I called him one night, and he was asking me what needed to be done. And I guess I sounded like I knew what I was talking about. I said, well, this certain molding has to be put on, and this has to be leveled, and we have to cut a hole here and there. He said, you sound like you knew a lot or something. He said, why don't you take the apprentice's test? And I said, no, I don't think, you know. Well, when's it given, you know? And he told me it was in the spring. And I said, well, you know, what's involved? And he said, well, mostly math, a few things about hand tools. And he said, well, you know, it can't hurt to try. So I took the test, passed, and was called for an interview. And you have to make it through those two stages, you know. And I think it was a day or two later, I got the letter from the carpenter saying, you made it, you know. The apprenticeship is a four-year apprenticeship. And I'm only a first-year apprentice. So I've got really three more years to go. And I really don't plan, you know, what I'm going to do when I'm a carpenter or what I'll be doing 10 years from now. But I definitely am going to go through with the apprenticeship. The men on the job have asked me, well, what's it going to be like when you get married and your husband doesn't want you to work? And I say, well, then I won't get married. You know, I would like to get married, but it'll be something that's going to be part of it. I'm going to finish my apprenticeship.
I love doing things. I love to be able to have the knowledge to be able to figure out, you know, something if it's broke, how to fix it, to be able to take care of things yourself without having to run, you know, to the first male to say, you know, I can't do this, you know, would you do it for me? You know, I like independence as a woman, as the type of woman I am.
When we were started on a program of looking for women and minorities, I went out to the technician training school and toured the school and talked to the placement officer down there. We picked what we thought were some of the best qualified people, and Valerie came out for interview, and she looked good to us, so we hired her into our carpentry group, and we haven't had any real problems since she came here. I think everybody adjusts. She adjusts, and so do the other guys in the carpentry shop. So I think it's gone very well.
I think it's a challenge for her. She has progressed real well in the line of work in comparison to some of the fellows we've even had in here.
Well, the only problems that I could think of in the beginning were my nervousness. I didn't know what I was going to be expected to do. I didn't know, you know, what I was going to be doing. But instead, it turned out to be that I'm still learning, you know, and they're still teaching me things all the time, just like they would any other apprentice, you know, male or female. I always wanted to be a carpenter, but I never thought I'd have the opportunity. And now that the times have finally changed and manpower is doing things to help women get into these jobs and that can't help themselves particularly get into them, they help me in a big way.
We take people who have obsolete skills or who are unskilled, and we provide training for them in what we hope are viable vocational fields. And when that training is completed, we set about finding jobs for them in the local labor market. I think a good example of that is one of our students who recently completed training in machine setup operation. This woman has two children, and she was, when she came to us, on DPA. Previously, she had worked as a barmaid, and she made about $68 a week. She came to us, she said she pointed out that she wanted to be useful, but she wanted to get enough money to support her family. And it was mentioned to her that she could go into one of the non-traditional fields. We let her know what the salaries ranges would be, and she decided that she would like to try it. And we already have her placed with General Electric. We can take these people on DPW, we can give them skills and enable them to get off of relief and get good jobs. Or we can take people who have to get supplemental DPW because the jobs that they are on do not pay them enough to support their families, give them skills that will get them into jobs that pay more wages than they got before.
Seem more interested in it, and they really want to get out there and make that dollar.
There really isn't any kind of woman who's interested in trades and skills. All kinds of women are. We have them all different shapes and sizes and colors and ages, and it would really be hard for me to peg them and, you know, put them into a slot. So many people have an image of a very masculine woman doing this kind of thing, but it isn't true.
Originally, when the so-called barrier was breached, where we had traditional male occupations being entered, or at least trying to be entered by women, certainly there was some negative feedback. There's still some negative feedback. I think some men that are in jobs that are worried that they're going to be replaced by women, but that's not the case. In reality, anybody can take a job away from anybody else, especially if the person looking for the job is better. And it's pretty much cut and dry. The job market's competitive, especially competitive these days. And whoever does the job the best is going to probably get the job and survive as an employee. It's not to say that one woman might not replace another.
Women have done skilled labor before, and they'll do it again. They're doing it now. It's here for them. There's no need for anybody to get stuck in a low-paying, dead-end type of job if they don't want to. And women work on the average of about 25 years out of their life. That's a long time to waste without skill or training or anything to fall back on. I think one thing that stops them from entering the trades is that they think it's all heavy, masculine work, and it really isn't. There's a lot of things that women do around the house that are very heavy, like carrying wet wash and 40-pound kids and things like that. That's feminine, where putting an electrical wire isn't supposed to be feminine. That's silly. There's no correlation there.
What would happen if you unfortunately were killed in an accident or if you dropped dead of a heart attack? Would you want your wife to be able to sustain your present lifestyle, take care of your children and educate them? And in all cases, individual answers yes, but he also tells me he has life insurance and whatnot. Then we get down to the bare facts of statistics. $20,000 worth of life insurance or $10,000 worth of life insurance today isn't going to pay for much. And ultimately, that woman who's then going to be the head of the household is going to have to provide, and she's going to have to provide adequately.
Well, I have three boys that I want to raise, and I want to give them everything that any other family would have if they had a father. Where I'm divorced and I am the breadwinner of that family, if they want to go to college, have nice clothes, I am the one that has to do it. And I would like to buy a home for them and have all the things that any other family would have. And that's why I'm into this. Really, for the money, the enjoyment, the whole challenge of the whole thing. I want something for my boys. And that's how I decided, yeah, this is good because I can make money. I can, you know, learn how to take care of my own family and give them a proper living instead of a meager little living that a waitress or a nurse or whatever can earn. And I really don't feel like I'm going into a non-traditional job. I just feel like I'm going to work for what I was trained to do. I can fix my own dishwasher. I've actually tried to fix my own car now, which is very difficult for me, but I can do it. I can fix my own washer, my own lights. I mean, it makes a great big difference. Things I would never have even thought about doing anything but plugging in electrical appliance, let alone dig inside and find out what made it work. It made a real big difference in me.
Big dream to work for Sears and Roebuck, you know, as the appliance repair person. I feel like, you know, they already ought to have a time card made out for me already because I'm going to go there to work. My mind's made up, that's what I want.
I feel that if they can do the job, and I can, as far as I'm concerned, and I can give them good service, and I am the breadwinner, I need that job as badly as any man, and I will work for my money and my promotion, I'm going to be just as good as any man. Definitely. I've proven that already.
Give us a chance. We'll prove you. We'll prove our worth. Give me a chance. I'll prove my worth.